Welcome back to a whole new chapter, which is called Euclidean and Unitary Vector Spaces. Now, this chapter is good news for everyone who doesn't like working with abstract fields, because we will only use real and complex vector spaces throughout this chapter. So we've kind of had the peak of the abstract considerations on vector spaces, and now we are going to focus on a bit more concrete things and going more to the situations that we are really then using in applications so far. As I told you in the beginning, we want to develop some calculus on R to the n, or in general on some finite dimensional vector spaces, and to generalize the calculus methods that we developed in Mathematics 1 to this multidimensional setting. Now, the idea for this is that we need several notions that we kind of use also to do calculus, that we need to transfer them to vector spaces. For example, we have when I talk about calculus, I'm talking about convergence, continuity, later differentiability, and so on. But first of all, for continuity and for convergence, what we needed there was kind of a notion of points which are close together. So how can you measure that some points are close, so that we always said that kind of x minus y into the absolute value is smaller than epsilon. There was some condition always appearing there, and we need to generalize this. We need to make measurements in vector spaces, and also we need to want to generalize some general geometric notions that we really need in vector spaces, like for example that we use in R2 or R3, this notion of length of a vector, where if you imagine vectors as arrows in R3 and so on, you have a clear picture in mind of what is the length. Also we have angles between vectors in two or three dimensional space, like we imagine this, and these are the notions that we want to generalize now to arbitrary real vector spaces, and then also develop a notion for complex vector spaces. Those vector spaces will also be important for you. I mean, you probably also have seen them in theoretical physics 1 at least, and they really pop up naturally in like quantum mechanics and other situations. So you really, we will develop kind of real and complex stuff simultaneously, or like in this first section a bit one after another, but we will see kind of both things and work out both ways and see kind of how both have the kind of natural analogs of the real constructions in the complex world. Now, to start, this first section is called inner products on real and complex vector spaces, and this is now a notion that I want to introduce. You've probably seen this in computations, some inner products or scalar products of vectors, which are kind of which associates to a pair of vectors a number, which kind of says very intuitively like how much these two vectors have in common. So to say, we will make this precise later on, we will talk about this in detail, but first in this notion we want to introduce this, then we will also see the notion of a norm, which is kind of generalizing the notion of length of vectors, and we will discuss these structures, see some examples, and establish some first properties. So I think this section should be relatively mild to understand, so we have seen worse. Okay, so let's start right away with the definition. Definition 10.1. Now, first of all, we take the real setting, so let V be a real vector space. So no abstract fields here. And inner product. Or scalar product. I mean, I'm pretty sure you've used this in your physics classes. Or scalar product on V. Is a map which we usually write in this, what are these brackets called? Should have looked this up. So in these, sketch this here. So we usually write this by inserting things in two components of such. Let me just cut here and look up what these brackets are called. Okay, these are called angle brackets. In German, they are called Spitze Klammern, just for curiosity, so if anyone was curious, because we write this by inserting a vector here and a vector here. And this is now a bit awkward to write this down in this way, but this is kind of the formalism here. We will see in a bit what I mean. So this angle bracket takes two vectors, so an element of V and another element of V, and gives back a real number. Okay, such a map, so somehow a multiplication of these vectors, such that three properties are satisfied. The first one is called bilinearity. Actually, I'm cheating because what I'm doing now is a bit less than bilinearity. I will say to you something about the next remark. after the next remark. So for all vectors, now I need v1, v2, and some v and some w in v, and all lambda in r. We have the following properties. If I take the inner product of a sum, v1 plus v2 in the first component, and in the second component another vector w, this is supposed to be the same as v1 as an inner product with w plus the inner product of v2 and w. Okay, so this is kind of a linearity property, and the other property is also a linearity property, namely if I have lambda times v comma w, so the inner product of lambda v and w, then I can pull the lambda out of this. So this is lambda times the inner product of v and w. So this is just multiplication of two real numbers. So for all I want to have this, and so in shorthand notation, if you take a look at this, you can rephrase this in a more fancy way by saying the map which we get if we take only the first component free and fix the second component as w and view this as a map. So this is equivalent to saying the map that we get like this. So we insert one vector and get a real number. This map here is linear. Okay. So for bilinearity, we actually need the same in the second component and the analogous equations, but they will follow from the properties as I will say later. But yeah, this is the idea here. So linear in both components should be the result. So this is linearity in the first component. The second property is a symmetry property. The symmetry of an inner product, namely we want that the inner product of V and W is always the same as the inner product of W and V. So it's commutative, so to say. This is for all V and W in V. And third property is called positive definiteness. Positive definiteness. Namely, we want that if we take the inner product of V with itself and V is non-zero, so it's just a non-trivial vector, then we always want to get something positive. So this should always be a positive number for all V in V without zero. Okay, these are the three properties of the inner product, and this is really just, you really need them all the time this chapter, so really please memorize them and really understand them properly. Okay, so these three properties. Now, then if this is an inner product, then the pair which consists of V and this product here, this is called a Euclidean vector space, which already explains part of the headline of this chapter. Vector space. So named after the great Greek mathematician Euclid, whom we probably also heard lots of times in when you had elementary geometry in high school, so a really famous ancient geometer. So this pair is called an Euclidean vector space. And maybe something as a little remark, so if it's clear which inner product we are using, then we just write V and not write this pair all the time. So write V instead of V comma with this brackets. I mean, we did the same with vector space operations and shortened our notation like this. If the inner product is apparent. So it's apparent which one we are using in there. Okay, now, as a first remark, I want to show you two properties that are already consequences of these three properties of inner products, and which are kind of standard properties which are kind of, yeah, important to use and which are quite reasonable if you take a look at them. So, remark 10.2. First of all, so we want a Euclidean vector space. Oops. Yeah, I haven't been saying what I wanted. So this explains part of the headline, Euclidean vector spaces. Unitary vector space will then be the analog for vector spaces over the complex numbers. So this will be just the, then we will also see an inner product in a bit, and then you will see the, yeah, the corresponding analog is a unitary vector space. So much for that. Okay, but now we're still with real numbers. So assume we have a Euclidean vector space. So now, first about this bilinearity property. For all V1, V2, VW in V, we compute. And my claim is that the analogous properties of this for the second component hold, and this is what I want to show. I want to call them W1, W2, and not V1, V2. Sorry, okay, like this. So if we have V comma W1 plus W2. So I want to show that there is linearity with respect to these summons as well, so that this is the inner product of these two and the inner product of V with W2. For this purpose, I first use the symmetry. So property 2, then this is the same as W1 plus W2 comma V. And now I can use this linearity in the first component that I established there. So this is property 1. Then we get that this is W1V inner product plus W2 comma V. And now to get our property, we just need to use the symmetry again in both of these products. Then we see that this, again by 2, is the same as VW1 plus VW2. So this additivity property holds in the second component as well. Now for the, yeah, for the other trick, we do the same thing. For the other property, we do the same thing. So we want to show that V comma lambda V, lambda W is the same as pulling lambda out of this inner product times, so we can just pull it out. So this is by symmetry the same as lambda W comma V. Now we can use this linearity property 1. Then this is the same as lambda times W comma V. And now by symmetry again, this is lambda comma times inner product of V and W. So in both variables, we can just pull constants out and we can use this addition property here. So we just need to check the one of them because we only need properties 1 and 2. We haven't used 3 here in this computation, but here we see that these are these already imply the same thing here for the other variable. Okay, so this of course can be saying that if we fix V and take this as a map in W by just inserting a variable into the second component here, that this map then is linear as well. So same as we did there. Okay, secondly, we can again compute by these properties of the inner product that the following holds by property 1. We get for all, if we take the inner product of something with 0, this is the same as, since 0 is the same as 0 plus 0, as this inner product, which is 0 comma v plus 0 comma v by property 1, which is 2 0v. Now, this equals this, so this number is twice itself, so this means this number has to be 0. So we get that 0 comma v, and this must be 0, and also by symmetry, this must be the same as v comma 0, and these two must be 0 for all v in v. So if one of the components is 0, the product immediately vanishes. Okay. So, so much for that. These were just two elementary properties and important properties of inner products. Okay, so before it goes on being dry, let's do some examples. So the first of all will be the example that probably you've all been waiting for, because this is the standard inner product which you probably used in your physics classes at some point. So namely, we consider r to the n, n is a fixed number. An inner product on R to the n is given as follows. Doing this rather quickly because you use this in your physics classes, and so it's not too exciting for you. So if we have the vector with entries x1, x2 to xn, and another vector y1, y2, and so on to yn, this is just supposed to be x1 times y1 plus x2, y2, and so on. So we just multiply always the ith component with the ith component of the other vector, and we take the sum of all of them. So this, this is an inner product. I'm not doing the, for all x1 to xn, y1 to yn in Rn, I'm not doing the computation of the three properties. I mean, the first of the linearity property is quite obvious, because multiplying this would be multiplying each entry, and so we would get, if we would put an additional lambda in front of here, this would then mean we would get an additional lambda in each of the summons here, and so just by distributivity of the real numbers, we can pull out the lambda in front of the sum, and then we have it. Symmetry is obvious, since multiplication in the real numbers is commutative, and the positive definiteness, that's also easy to see, because this would be then just the sum. If both would be the same, we would have here x1 squared, x2 squared, and so on, and xn squared, which is always non-negative, and it's only zero if all the components are zero. So if as soon as one of them is non-zero, we get a positive number. Okay, it's just verbally like this. And this inner product, we will call this inner product is called the standard inner product or Euclidean inner product. And later on, when we're doing calculus, most of the time we will be using this inner product. So the standard inner product or Euclidean inner product on R to the n. Standard inner product or Euclidean inner product. Okay, to see a bit more interesting examples, let me erase and then give you two more ways of getting two more examples of inner products. Given the standard inner product, we can use this and produce a machinery to produce many, many new inner products on R to the n. Namely, if we have this to be the is the standard inner product on R to the n, and if we have an invertible n by n matrix, GLN R, so a real matrix, invertible real matrix with of size n, then we can produce new inner products, which I will call now inner product with index A here as a name. Then this, so inner product on Rn, so we take two elements of Rn and get back a real number. By simply taking xy, A is defined to be the standard inner product, the standard inner product of A times x and A times y. So just multiplying everything with A, this is an inner product on R to the n. In fact, it is impossible to show that every inner product on Rn has this form. So for each inner product, we can find an invertible matrix such that there is such a relation here. This is probably, if I have enough time, I will prove this in one or two lectures, so we will probably see this, but anyway. So this is a nice way of producing new inner products from old ones. Now, as a third example, I want to give you an inner product on more interesting, nothing against R to the n, but on some more complicated vector space, namely on an infinite dimensional vector space. We take the following. So let A be in R with A smaller than B, then, an inner product, which I will also now use just the angle brackets here, on the following vector space. We take the real vector space of continuous functions from AB to R. So two continuous functions on this compact interval, going from there to R. Right, this was a real vector space by pointwise multiplication with constants. And defined the following way, the inner product of f and g, so we have two continuous functions now, should be the integral going from a to b over f of x, g of x, dx. The integral of the product of these functions. This may look a bit awkward at first sight, but it turns out this is really essential and really useful. This is something that will pop up a lot when you assume, I mean, in quantum mechanics you will need this, but also everything, everywhere you analyze kind of functions or where you have, where your points are functions in your vector space. This is one of the most important inner products there is, actually. Now, okay, this is a simple construction, so let's maybe convince ourselves that this is really an inner product. So first of all, yeah, the bilinearity property. So if I have the sum somewhere in one of the two components, so let's assume in the first one, so assume we have here f1 plus f2, then we would here have f1 plus f2 there, so multiply everything with g, and so we would have an integral of a sum, but we know that the integral of a sum is the sum of the integrals, and so by just this linearity property of integrals, this implies that this has precisely this, the linearity property that we want. So this follows from linearity properties of the Riemann integral. Okay, now, second point, symmetry. This is obvious. If we have the inner product of g and f, this would be just the integral of g of x times f of x, and of course this is commutative in R, so this doesn't matter. This is obvious. Now the only interesting part is the positive definiteness, and I'm claiming that we have already proven this in the last semester. Namely, first of all, if we take the inner product of f with itself, so for some continuous function, this would be the integral from a to b over f of x squared dx. So just the square of the function here. Now, we know that this is a square of a real function, so it's always bigger than or equal to zero. And then we've seen if this is the lower bound for the function, we get if we integrate over a non-negative function, this must also be bigger than or equal to zero. Okay, so now we know that for every f, so for all f in C0 from A, B to R. Okay, so we know that it's bigger than or equal to zero, so we know we have to single out the cases in which it's equal and which it is bigger than, strictly bigger than zero, so let's check for this case of zero, of being this being zero. So this is the case if and only if A, B, f of x squared, this integral here is zero, and again, this here is non-negative, and there was an exercise about this, saying that if we have a continuous non-negative function and we build the integral over this, then, if we have a continuous non-negative function and the integral over this is zero, then the function itself must be zero. This was precisely an exercise in the last semester. This was, Math 1, Sheet 11. It all comes back here. Sheet 11 and exercise 1. So this shows the positive definiteness. So this means this is zero if and only if, this is actually an if and only if the function itself is zero. So f, the inner product of f with itself is positive for all f in C0 AB R without the zero function. And so this shows that this is an inner product. Okay, we'll probably see this later again. So this is a very important and interesting inner product. Okay, this was inner products for real vector spaces. And as I've already said, we want to do the complex setting again. And there we have some very, very small differences, very subtle differences. And let me just discuss this case explicitly. 10.4. So let's take a look at the complex setting. So now V is a complex vector space. Just as a general remark, in the exams for Math 1, I've noticed that some of you have really great difficulty still working with complex numbers. Please, please study this, and you have to get familiar with kind of computing with complex numbers. It's really not that hard. You just have to get used to it. You have to do the computations some again and again and the different ways of writing complex numbers. But please just do yourself a favor and learn properly about complex numbers. Okay, now an inner product on a complex vector space. So inner product on V is now a map which I again write in these angle brackets going from V times V, but this time it should take values in C and not in R. Okay, so a map such that, and now the three properties are almost the same. So first of all, so the first one is the same for all, so this linearity again, for all V1, V2, V, and W in V, it holds that, and now same thing, V1 plus V2 comma W is the same as the inner product of V1 and W plus the inner product of V2 and W, and lambda V comma W is lambda times the inner product of V and W. Now, this time there's a slight difference in the second component. So it does not follow an analogy with before that we have the same in the second component, but there's a slightly different notion of this, which we will, the reason for this is the second property, the symmetry property, which is slightly different now. So for all V and W in C, we want that the inner product of V with W. Now we had before that this should be in the real setting, this should be the inner product of W and V, and here we have a simple difference, the complex conjugate. This here is a complex number, and this is just conjugation in C. Please get yourself familiar with conjugation and so on as well. So this is the complex conjugate of this number. So we only want to have it to be symmetric up to conjugation so far. So this, sometimes you can also call this conjugate symmetric or whatever, but I will not give this, not introduce additional terminology for this, but this is just, so it's slightly shifted, so only to conjugation. And the third property is the positive definiteness, and this is also the same. Now we want that V, that this is positive, and since this might actually be a complex number, that may be precise, this should be, first of all, it's a real number, and it's a positive real number. So remember, this is in general complex, so in particular, this is the first requirement that it's real, and then we have to demand that this is positive. So this holds for all V in V without zero. Okay, so then V together with such an inner product is called a unitary vector space. What's vector space? Yes. Okay, and again, I'm not writing this down again. If it's clear which inner product we're using, we just write V instead of writing this product there all the time, so in the same as in the real case. Okay, now, this teeny tiny difference here, this conjugation, this leads to a slightly different behavior in the second component. And let me put this into remark 10.5, so let's take a look at the same points that we looked at in the real case. So consider a unitary vector space. Okay, then first of all, for all V1, V2, no, sorry, V, again, W1, W2, V, and W in V, we compute, and now let's check what the linearity in the second component does. So first of all, the first point is still easy, because if we take the inner product of V with W1 plus W2. Now to use this, we can use the symmetry property. We just have to add this conjugate bar. So by 2, this is the same as W1 plus W2 comma V, the inner product conjugate. Now by the first property, this is the same as W1 V plus W2 V conjugate. And Now if I would have an audience, this would be another question for you. What does the audience, what does conjugation do with respect to sums of complex numbers? The good news is they are compatible. We've seen that this is always the same as W1 V conjugate plus W2 V conjugate. So this is just elementary properties of complex conjugation. And now we can use the symmetry backwards. So this now by 2 is the same as V W1, and now the conjugation bar vanishes again, plus VW2. Okay, so in the second component we have this additivity property as well, same as in the real case. So yeah, product of V with W1 plus W2 is the same as the sum of the two inner products. But the difference is now with respect to multiplying with a constant in the second variable. Oh yes, for all these numbers, and I can also do this right here, so that lambda now be a complex number, and assume we have these inner products of the form V with lambda W. Now there's a difference, because now this is, again by symmetry, first of all, this is lambda W comma V, and now the conjugate of this. Now we can use the linearity property, because now we can pull lambda outside. So this is by property 1, the same as lambda times WV conjugate. Now, what about the conjugate of a complex product? This will also be a question for the audience. What does the conjugation do with respect to multiplication? And here we know it's also compatible. We've seen in the last semester this is the same as the conjugate of lambda times the conjugate of WV, and now we can use the symmetry in reverse. And lambda conjugate remains as it is, and the second conjugation bar vanishes. So, if we have a constant multiplication with a scalar here in the second variable, we can pull this out, but with a conjugate. So it shifts by this conjugation. This is also called, you can call this complex antilinear, or semi-linearity is probably the proper word. This is called this phenomenon semi-linearity or complex anti-linearity. So it's kind of linear up to conjugation, very informally spoken. Okay, so this is important. And if you have the constant in the second component, this gets conjugated before continuing. Okay, and in the second remark, the same as for Euclidean vector spaces, we have seen that inner products with the zero are always zero. And if we take a look at the conjugation steps, it's the same. So we get that V comma zero is the same as 0 comma V is equal to 0 for all V in V. So this is unchanged in the complex setting. If one of them is 0, it's vanishing. Okay, now, let me do a quick example. And now here I will be a bit, so in German you would say I will treat the complex inner products for now quite stiefmütterlich. Stepmotherly would be the English translation, but I don't think this works. I will only care for them a little bit and only do a little bit about them, because the focus shall now first of all be on the real setting, but I want to treat the complex simultaneously, because you can see all the steps, basically all the computations can be done in both settings at once. But, so we've seen on R to the n there's a standard inner product, and the same holds true for C to the n. Okay, again, n and n. So the standard inner product, this is what we call it. On C to the n is given as follows. So let's take Z1 to Zn, so an n tuple of complex numbers, and another one, W1 to Wn, and let's take the inner product of these. So if we would just mimic the real case, we would get that this is Z1 W1 plus Z2 W2 and so on plus Zn Wn. So this would be kind of the straightforward way, the naive way of writing down the inner product. The problem is, this is not an inner product. So first of all, the symmetry goes wrong. I mean, there's no need for conjugation in this setting. But also, and this is now important, and it's basically the reason why we have to do all this, these conjugations and so on. If we now would check property three, let's assume we would have the same vector here. We would have z1 to zn, and so here on the in both entries, and here we would get z1 squared plus z2 squared plus zn squared. So why is this bad news? Question for the audience, which is not there. So the problem is z1 squared does not need to be a real number. The square of a complex number does not need to be real. So we want really that this is a real positive number, so this doesn't work. Now, this is the problem with this thing. So we would have a sum of squares of complex numbers, which we don't know anything about. But we can make a subtle change to this product, which first of all gives us this symmetry up to conjugation and property three. So first of all, let us here enter let's fix this. So we just need to replace W1 and W2 and so on by its conjugates, by their conjugates. Here conjugation, and so on, until we conjugate here. So we take all of these conjugates. Okay, now, why is this more interesting for three? Let's take the following consideration. So if I take z1 to zn and z1 to zn in both slots, now, so the inner product would then be z1, z1 bar plus and so on plus zn, zn bar. Okay, and now another question for the audience. Does this look familiar? What happens if I take a complex number and the product with this conjugate? This we've seen is just the absolute value squared. So this is z1 to the absolute value squared plus z2 to the absolute value squared and so on. And it becomes this. And since we know that the absolute value is zero if and only if the number is zero, this means this has to be positive as soon as one of these numbers is non-zero. So this really gives us the crucial property here. So here you can see kind of why this conjugation is needed. Okay, let me erase and then we'll study properties of these inner products on real and complex vector spaces. We will now prove a very important inequality, which is one of the most important results for inner products, although it might not look that spectacular, but it turns out this is really extremely useful. The so-called Cauchy-Schwarz inequality. Now, assume we have a Euclidean or a unitary vector space. This works in both settings. So Euclidean or a unitary vector space. Then the following holds. If we take the absolute value of the inner product of two vectors V and W and square this, so yeah, if it's, remember if it's unitary vector space, this is really the complex absolute value. The square is smaller than or equal to the inner product of V with itself times the inner product of W with itself for all V and W in V. We will see a slight reformulation of this later on, but this is kind of a very elementary inequality, and this can be really proven in a straightforward way. So we will only consider the unitary case, because basically the Euclidean case is the same proof. You just have to replace, so at some point we will choose a constant in C, just replace this by just taking constants in R and forget about all the conjugations that will appear in the proof. Then you will immediately get the real case, so the unitary case is all we will need for this proof here. Okay, so first of all, I want to make one distinguish between two cases. So the first, the easiest case is if W is zero, then we know that scalar product with zero are zero, so there's zero on the left-hand side, and here we have zero on the right-hand side. So in this case, the equality is, inequality reads as zero is smaller than or equal to zero, which is obviously true. So assume in the following, that W is non-zero, and what we need about this is that then by property three of the inner product, it follows that the inner product of W with itself is a positive number. Actually, we only need that it's non-zero, but anyway. Now, let's make a following computation just by using inner products. We choose, we can use all the space here, for some number lambda, we can choose some arbitrary complex number lambda, we compute the following. Now, it might not be obvious why we're doing this, we'll see this later on. So let's take the inner product of two vectors, but then v minus lambda times w, and take the inner product with itself. So the inner product of v minus lambda times w with v minus lambda times w. We make a computation about these numbers here, and then we will insert a smart choice of lambda, which then gives us the inequality. This is why we're doing this. First of all, this is the inner product of a vector with itself. So if this vector here, v minus lambda w, is non-zero, this must be a positive number. If it is zero, then it's just zero coming out of there. So in all cases, this is smaller than or equal to zero. Oh, I forgot part of the proof, I'm sorry. Part of the statement. I'm sorry, let me just insert this here. This inequality is true and also equality holds. So this is really equal. Holds if and only if the two vectors are linearly dependent. So one is a multiple of the other. If and only if v and w are linearly dependent, otherwise it's really a strict inequality. Okay, sorry about that. Now, we have seen that this is smaller, bigger than or equal to zero, but we can also now use the linearity properties of inner products to make a further computation of this. Namely, I won't write the properties down every time, but now we first use the linearity in the first component, namely the inner product of this here with that is the same as the inner product of v with this, plus the inner product of minus lambda w with v minus lambda w. Okay, now we can use the linearity in the second component, so with the additivity and so on, to decompose it by this and by this, meaning this is the same as the inner product of v with v plus the inner product of v with minus lambda w. This is here the inner product of minus lambda w with v plus the inner product of minus lambda w and minus lambda w. Okay, now there's constants inside this product, and we know that the constants can be pulled out of this, only that we have to conjugate in a few occasions. Now, first of all, this is unchanged. Here we can, so it's the unitary case, and we have a constant in the second component, so we can pull it out if we add a conjugate. So here, the minus, this conjugation doesn't change this, so the minus just, this plus becomes a minus, and then we get the conjugate of lambda times the inner product of v and w, and here we just can take this out of the equations in the first slot, so this is just minus lambda of the inner product v, w times v. And here now we have two signs, first of all, so minus minus becomes plus, and this one can be pulled out without conjugation, this one with. And now what happens if we do it in both slots? It's just one after the other. So the result is first pulling lambda out gives a factor of lambda, then pulling this one out gives a factor of lambda bar times v, w. Okay. So much for that. So we have this strange inequality here, and one more change. I want to restore the order here, so use the symmetry property, and this means this is the same as, so maybe let's get from above, so this is the same as equivalent to zero is smaller than or equal to this minus lambda bar v w minus lambda, and now the symmetry again holds up to conjugation, so this is the inner product of v and w conjugate, plus lambda lambda bar ww. Okay, now this is some tedious computation, but now we just need to make a smart choice of lambda. Namely, lambda was an arbitrary complex number, and we insert the following now. Lambda should be equal to the inner product of vw divided by the inner product of w with w. Okay, what does this help? this yields, so let's insert this in this equation. So we have 0 is smaller than VV, and now we have the conjugate of lambda. We know that the denominator here, this is a positive number, in particular it's a real number, so the conjugation is, this doesn't matter. And the conjugation of the product or of a fraction here is the fraction of the two conjugates, and since the second one is unchanged, this is lambda bar is the same as the conjugate of the inner product of V and W, and this guy divided by the inner product of times inner product of V and W minus, and now we get lambda, so inner product of V and W divided by inner product of WW times VW bar. And here we find this, so here it gets a bit messy. So here we have first lambda itself. So VW inner product divided by WW inner product times lambda conjugate. So this is VW conjugate times W divided by WW. And finally, we just multiply by the inner product of W with itself. I hope you can still read this. Now, here, of course, we can divide things out here. So this cancels this. And now if we take a look at the three summands here, so this is minus something, but this is minus the same thing, and this is plus the same thing. So we have three times the same guys with different signs. So which means two of them cancel each other out. So this cancels with this, so that the inequality becomes a lot simpler. We get 0 is smaller than or equal to the inner product of V times V with itself minus the inner product of V times V with W times the conjugate divided by the inner product of V comma W with itself. And now recall, a number times its conjugate is the square of the absolute value. So this becomes V V minus, and now the absolute value of VW squared and divided by WW. And if you take a look at what I'm going to show, now we're done. Because we just need to take this and bring this guy to the other side and multiply by the denominator, then we're done. So rearranging terms shows the claim. So, if equality holds, so now the second part that I added afterwards, so for this we observe that equal, this holds. So by just tracing back the whole computation, we get that there's some lambda such that this there must be zero. This must be equal to zero because the rest of us were just reformulations. So there must be some lambda in C an implication in this direction. So this implies that there is some lambda in C such that V minus lambda W, V minus lambda W is zero. But we know that a multiplication of something with itself is zero if and only if the vector is zero. So this can only be the case if V is lambda times W. So this shows the one direction, and the other implication, so that if they are linearly dependent, then equality holds. This is a simple computation, so this is what I want to do. Other implication follows by a straightforward computation. Okay, so this inequality will turn out to be really important because you kind of need this all the time as a computational tool. It's kind of like a Swiss Army knife or something, which is kind of, you might not think it's so spectacular, but you can really use this sometimes very well. Okay, now, this is, first of all, this is inner products and one of the main properties of them. Now there's this notion of a norm, which is strictly related, or which is closely related to the one of inner products, which I want to introduce now, and I will now give a new definition of something which is actually doesn't look like it has to do with this, but we will see where the connection lies later on. And the notion of norm is quite equally, is very important by itself. We have seen inner products are something where you can kind of compare two vectors, and this will also then be used to kind of measure the angle between two vectors in a bit. But it turns out that norms are important because norms are generalizations of the length of a vector. So what should the length of some one single vector? I mean, this is just multiplying vectors, but I want to give you one vector and get back the length of a vector. So this should be a function which just needs one vector and gives me the length. And this is something we will also introduce again by similar properties as for inner products and see what the consequences of these properties are. Now, let's generalize the length. Definition 10.8. This is also in the definition that we will really, I mean, norms will be used throughout this lecture until, probably until Mach 4 or something. But this is, very elementary and important considerations, as we shall see later on, also when we do calculus. Okay, let V be a vector space, let's write a full sentence, let V be a vector space over, and now it's the same for both real and complexes, complex vector spaces, so either K is equal to R or K is equal to C. In both cases, we have the same. A norm on V is a map. Now we will write this a bit like the absolute value, so which would be like the absolute value would be this, so just putting something in between two vertical bars. And to single out the difference between norm and absolute value, we take two bars on both sides. So put this both in two vertical bars. This is now a map which takes a vector v and gives me back a length. And also in a complex case, a length should be something which is a real number. So we want a map from v to r such that, and now what should be the kind of reasonable properties of something which generalizes length? First of all, negative length makes no sense, like intuitively. So we want that the norm of a vector v is always bigger than or equal to zero for all v in v, and we want that the length of v is zero. I mean, what should length zero mean? This, with this we want, I mean, if we imagine vectors as arrows coming out of the origin in R to the n, this should only hold if v itself is zero. Okay, so this is the first property. Then, what should be the norm of some constant scalar times a vector? I mean, multiplying vector with a scalar would be like kind of stretching and so expanding the vector or shrinking the vector. So this should be kind of a factor for shrinking and so on. And of course, the length somehow, the length, if we stretch it, the length should become bigger by this stretching factor. And same with shrinking. And now lambda could be a complex number or a negative number or something. So this basically indicates in which direction we kind of shrink the vector or something or move it. Now, this we just want to be by the shrinking or expanding factor, and this would be, then if we think about the effect on length and so on, this is just the absolute value of lambda times the norm of v. This should be the case. So about shrinking and expanding for all lambda in k, so k is r or c, depending on which case we're in, and for all vectors v in v. And the third property is now a straightforward generalization of a property of the absolute value, namely the so-called triangle inequality. We want that the norm of v plus w is smaller than the norm of v plus the norm of w for all v and w in v. Okay, and just for the name triangle inequality, let's just draw a little triangle here somewhere in the corner. I think I did the same picture in Math 1 at some point. Assume we have some, let's assume we're in R2. We have the origin here in R2, and we have two vectors, v and w. Now, what v plus w would be just, so we first, this is, I mean, we didn't do this property in class with vectors, but you should know this from high school or from your physics courses. So adding two vectors would be just concatenating. So first following the one and then the other. So if we would have v, we would go for, first go here and then add the vector v here. So about here, this would be v plus w. So maybe let's do this completely. So this would be again a shifted version of w, a bit sloppy here. So this point would be v plus w. So let's draw this connection vector here and forget about the original w. So now we got a triangle. So this would be the vector v plus w. This is v, this is w. And now This tells us that the length of this short side is smaller than or equal to the sum of the lengths of the two other sides. This makes sense concerning what we know about triangles. This is not very exciting here. But this is where the name triangle inequality comes from. So this is kind of reasonable behavior for a map which we want to generalize length. Now then, the pair of a real or complex vector space together with a norm is called a normed vector space. And again, as for inner products, we just write V instead of this pair, write V for V and norm if it's apparent which norm we are using. Okay. Let's maybe do like this. So we have seen that the inner products are defined by some axioms and norms are defined by some axioms. And I told you that norms and inner products have a relation, and this relation is now established in the following result. So this is another hybrid of theorem and definition. So assume we have a Euclidean or unitary vector space then we can use this inner product to produce a norm, namely then the norm, which I denote by these double vertical bars from V to R, which is defined as follows. The norm of V is defined as the square root of the inner product of V with itself. This is well defined because we've seen by the inner product properties that this is either positive or zero, so the square root is defined. So this is a norm on V. This is the theorem part, and we call, this is now definition part, this norm the norm induced by the inner product by these angle brackets. Okay, so every inner product defines a norm on the same vector space. I will prove this, but first let me erase.